Good morning.
Morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity into this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established brand schools throughout the United States and Canada in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and title for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language till some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible rendering for the true and correct name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart, show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within this pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word, our Son. A superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up your one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof of that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, is to help you find and know Yahweh Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law of the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating a mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. And eighth, is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save being the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. I watch her with peace, and our slogan is Speak the Truth. We have a prayer this morning by Dr. Lloyd Lawless, a scripture lesson of Romans 11th chapter by Dr. Irene Ramirez.
Good afternoon, class.
Good morning.
Let's all bow our hearts and mind in prayer. Heavenly Father Yahweh, we thank you once again for inviting us to this new stupendous and miraculous teaching that we are now placed upon us. we hope that many more will come in that same posture. We also hope that those that are listening in would get a better understanding of this teaching, and that they would also invite others to attend class or either listen in on the broadcast. All these things we ask in your only begotten Son's name, Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
I'll be reading Romans, the 11th chapter in the Millennium Bible. I say then, hath Yahweh cast away his people? By no means. For I also am an Israelite, of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. Yahweh has not cast away his people which he foreknew. Know ye not that the scriptures say of Elijah, how he maketh intercession to Yahweh against Israel, saying, Yahweh, they have killed thy prophets and digged down thy altars, and I am left alone, and they seek my life. But what saith the answer of Yahweh unto him? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. Even so, then at this present time, also there is a remnant according to the election of grace. And if by grace, then is no more by works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace, but it shall be of works. Then is it no more grace, otherwise work is more work. What saith, Israel hath not obtained that which he seeketh for. But the election hath obtained it, and the rest were blind. According as it is written, Yahweh hath given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see, and ears that they should not hear, unto this day. And David saith, let their table be made a snare, and a trap, and a stumbling block, and a recompense unto them. Let their eyes be darkened, that they may not see, and bow down their back always. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? By no means, but rather through their fall salvation is come unto the nations, for to provoke them to jealousy. Now if the fall of them be of riches of the world, and the diminishing of them the riches of the nations, how much more their fullness? For I speak to you, nations, inasmuch as I have the apostle of the nations. I magnify my office. If by any means I may provoke the immolation, them which are of my people, and might save some of them. For if the casting away of them be the reconciliation of the world, what shall the receiving of them be, but left from the dead, for if the first fruits be holy, the rest also holy, and if the root be holy, so are the branches. And if some of the branches be broken off, and thou being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, and with them partakest of the fruit and the fatness of the olive tree, boast not against the branches, but if thou boast, thou bearest not the root. But the root thee, thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off, and I may be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief, they were broken off, and thou standest thy faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. For if Yahweh spare not the natural branches, taketh heed lest he also spare not thee. Behold therefore the goodness and the serenity of Yahweh on them which fell severity. But towards them goodness, if thou continue in his goodness, otherwise they also shall be cut off. And they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in. For Yahweh is able to graft them in again. For if thou wast cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to nature into the good olive tree, how much more shall these, which be the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree? For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceit, that blindness is happened to a part of Israel, and to the plain of it for Israel be consummated. And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, and shall be turned away wickedness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. As concerning the evangel, they are enemies for your sake. But as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sake. For the gift and calling of Yahweh are without alteration. For as ye in past times have not believed Yahweh, yet have now obtained mercy through their unbelief. Even so have these also now not believed, that through your mercy they also may obtain mercy. For Yahweh hath concluded them all in unbelief, that he might have mercy upon all. Oh, the deep of the riches both of wisdom and knowledge of Yahweh, hath unsearchable are his judgment and his ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of Yahweh, or who hath been his counselor, or who has the first given to him, and it shall be recompensed unto him again. For of him and through him and to him all are all things, whom be glory forever. Let's all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Our first speaker this morning will be Dr. Chinoway Clydesman, speaking on the conversion of the Gentiles.
Before I start, I say that I've been watching a lot of lectures from other classes, and some classes prepared, like they call maybe three or four people, and they all say, oh, but they don't want to speak. But you know, we're always saying praise Yahweh and everything, and everybody can get up and say something, even if it's just your name, I'm thankful for being here. But it was like four or five people were just, you know, refusing to get up at all. And so you're not expected to give a great speech, but just even to give a brief testimony. Anyway, I'm diverting from the title. I was volunteered for this grafting of the Gentiles by Joe. And so it's like army style volunteering, you know. And I've given it several times, and I find that each time I learn something, before I would go straight to grafting in. Then I learn more and more how important it is that we start everything with Moses. And I understand now how it takes our picture. So when Moses was born, he was given the Holy Spirit. And Yahweh told him to take I'm just going to go over the highlights and not pick on anybody. He was told to take the children of Israel out of Egypt. And so he said, well, what shall we call you? Because they called him El Shaddai, and they didn't know what his real name was. So let's go to Exodus 3:13.
Exodus 3:13. And Moses said unto Abraham, behold, when I come unto you, unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the Elohim of your fathers hath sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And Elohim said, Moses, Eir, I shall Eir. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I will be, hath sent me unto you. And Elohim said moreover unto Moses, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, Yahweh, the Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob hath sent me unto you. This is my name forever. This is my memorial unto all generations.
Okay, so forever is a long time. And it's really important we find as we use these names. Now Moses was told to go up to the mount alone and by himself. Mm-hmm. And he went up with Yahshua. So, but he was really alone. And King James, read 1 John 5:7.
5:7?
In King James.
For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one.
Okay, so these three are one, which means that if he went up, the different manifestations of Yahweh, these three are one, so he was going up with the person that told him to come up, and he transmuted into Elohim, and then again into this tabernacle pattern. So these three people that we know that saw the vision are Moses, John, and Dr. Kinley. And they were each were purposed to show us a little bit. Moses was shown the tabernacle pattern, how everything fits the pattern. And when you listen to the moderation, it's sort of like an outline of everything we're studying. I'm getting a lot of feedback. And if you break this down, you learn everything you need to know. Dr. Kinley drew these charts, and it helps me because I'm a visual learner. And when I see these things, I can understand it better. Now, let's go to Exodus 24:9. No, the first time he went up, he was told all the commandments. And Israelites said, all that Yahweh has said we will do. Okay, so now he goes up, Exodus 24:9.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the Elohim of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone, and as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
Okay, and go to for the seventh day, 16.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
Okay, so what happened then after that seventh day? There's a colon, which means that he's explaining what happened up here. And so we learn that Genesis actually should be the first book because it was written by Moses as well as the first five books of the Bible. So this is, in the beginning Elohim created the heavens and the earth. Well, that's not the beginning of the Bible in Genesis. It's the beginning of Moses' vision. Okay. So I'm going to skip over now to Abraham. So get the textbook, Volume 4, page 22. So we have different, it's also in Genesis, and also Dr. Kinley explained it through his textbook. He had these charts drawn, and he wrote these books so that he could explain the mysteries of the Bible and the history around it.
We got the Elohim book, page 22, the priesthood and kinship of Melchizedek and the Abrahamic covenant of promise.
Yes.
According to the purpose and choice of Yahweh in the dispensations of time, it was to Abraham and his seed, not seeds, that Yahweh made the covenant of promise. That is, in his Abraham's seed, who is the Messiah, he would bless all of the families of the earth.
The the families of the earth meant everybody, and at that time, everybody was what they call nations, but they're actually everybody was a Gentile. Okay.
The promise was made 430 years before the giving of the law. It was after Abraham went down into Egypt because of the famine and returned to Canaan that Melchizedek, the high priest and king of Salem, who was ordained of Yahweh, met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him while the seed was still in his loins. Explanatory note. Let us take advantage of this opportunity here and now to say that the scriptures do not say that Yahweh, who was manifested in Yahshua the Messiah, would set up the earthly kingdom or church upon flesh and blood, or any man on the earth plane. Moreover, Yahweh said through Daniel before the birth of Yahshua the Messiah that the kingdom would not be left to others.
Okay, let's go down to where he receives the covenant.
When Abraham was 90 years old?
Right.
Elohim appeared to him again and said, I am the Almighty Yahweh Elohim. Walk before me and be thou perfect. And I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. Abraham, at the age of 100 years, was given a son, Isaac, by Sarah, as Yahweh had promised. After Isaac was weaned, Sarah saw the son of Hagar mocking and said to Abraham, let it not be grievous in thy sight because of the lad and because of thy bondwoman. In all that Sarah has said unto thee, hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called. And also of Ishmael, the son of the bondwoman, I will make a nation, because he is thy seed.
Okay, so from Isaac came the 12 tribes, and also Ishmael had 12 tribes. Okay, read.
Yahweh had given Abraham the covenant of circumcision, saying unto him to circumcise himself, Ishmael, and all of his household, which Abraham did that day, as Yahweh had commanded. Isaac was circumcised on the eighth day after he was born, as the scripture saith, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called. The scripture clearly set forth that Yahweh chose Abraham to establish the dispensation of faith under Melchizedek, king and high priest of Salem.
Okay, thank you. So that shows the start that he was the first Hebrew, and in order to be a Hebrew, you had to be circumcised on the eighth day. So let's go back to Moses, and he saw Adam in the garden. And this is really important because Adam had to do what he was ordered to do in order for us to have to need salvation. So Adam was placed in the garden, and Dr. Kinney wrote a transcript that said Adam is Yahweh Elohim, which means that when you talk about in the moderation about the fiery cloud, what was that? Yahweh is not a cloud.
He really chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form.
And what? You know, did somebody say that part of the moderation about the cloud where everything?
Oh, cloud symbolizes.
Give him a microphone.
Yahweh is represented and symbolized as a fiery cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud, but he's symbolized as a fiery cloud that goes all the way around the edges of the chart, showing you that everything on the chart abides within the cloud.
Okay.
It says everything abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh.
Okay, so just in the moderation alone, we understand this everything, including Adam, who was placed there. He is also Yahweh Elohim. Now, Lucifer tempted Eve, his wife, and he partook, so Adam was out of the garden and this veil was closed. So death reigned from Adam to Moses, meaning everybody was under the Mosaic law, even when Yahshua came. So let's go to the place where John the Baptist is born. I read so many scriptures that they're all kind of mixed up in my mind.
Second chapter of Luke, first chapter, Luke 1 and 1. For as much as many have taken in hand to set forth the order, the declaration of those things which are most surely believed unto us, even as they delivered them unto us, which from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word. It seemed good to me also, having investigated carefully all things from the very beginning, to write them unto thee, in order, most excellent Theophilus, that thou mightest know the certainty of those things wherein thou hast been instructed. There was in the days of Herod the king of Judah a certain priest named Zechariah, of the course of Abia, and his wife was the daughter of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both religious, both Yahweh, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of Yahweh blameless. And they had no children because that Elizabeth was barren, and they both were now well stricken in age and years. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before Yahweh in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of Yahweh.
Go to 13.
But the angel of Yahweh, but the angel said unto him, Fear not. I was almost there. Let me finish this here.
Okay.
And the whole, and the quote, 10 verse. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of Yahweh standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, Fear not, Zechariah, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth, for he shall be great in the sight of Yahweh, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to Yahweh their Elohim, and he shall go before him in the spirit and the power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the obedient and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for Yahweh. And Zechariah said unto the angel, Whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife well stricken in years. And the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel, that stand in the presence of Yahweh, and am sent to speak unto thee, and to show thee these glad tidings. And behold, thou shalt be dumb, not able to speak until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season.
So Zacharias was mute until it came to the birth of John. And go to 24.
And after those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived and hid herself 5 months, saying, Thus have Yahweh dealt with me in the days wherein he looked upon me. Take away my reproach among men. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from Yahweh unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Miriam.
So this explains also that about the Old Testament talks and prophesies about the virgin birth. And Mary was troubled because she had been with no man, and she and Joseph were going to be married. And he was kind of disturbed because he didn't want her to, you know, the law said you had to be stoned and all that. So Yahweh came to him and told him that this was from the Holy Spirit, and that Mary, you know, that Mary was not consorting with somebody else. So they went to visit, and John was given the Holy Spirit. So go to 32.
And he shall.
Oh, wait, go to 31.
31. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Yahshua. And he shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And Yahweh Elohim shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there shall be no end.
Okay, so since Holy Spirit recognizes Holy Spirit, where was that? Where they saw he leapt, leapt.
35, and the angel, wait, 34, I guess. Then said Miriam unto the angel, how shall this be, saying, I know not a man? Am I there? Or am I
no, it was where the babies recognized each other, and they both had the Holy Spirit, and they left in the womb.
And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth said, have also conceived a son in her old age, and this sixth month be with her, who was called barren. For Yahweh saw nothing be impossible. And Miriam said, behold, the handmaiden of Yahweh, it be unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her.
No, that's not the word.
Luke 1:44. 44, let me go down. For lo, as soon as the voice of the salutation sounded in my ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. And blessed is she that believeth, for there shall be a performance of those things which were told her from Yahweh.
So the Holy Spirit recognized, so both of the fetuses leapt in the womb.
Leaped
in the womb. So they have the Holy Spirit now. We'll go to after, since Yahshua was a carpenter's son, he spent his childhood being a carpenter. And when he was 12 years old, his family went to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. And as they left, Mary and Joseph left, they didn't realize that Yahshua was not with them. So they went back and they were chastising him. And let's see, where is that?
Luke 49. And he said unto them, how is it that ye sought me? Know ye not that I must be about my Father's business? And they stood about him, saying, which he stayed unto them. Is that right, Lord?
Yes.
And he went down with them, and they came to Nazareth.
Okay,
and he was subject.
That's the main thing. Wist you not that I would be about my Father's business? And Mary really didn't understand a lot of these things, even if she was told about what, you know, what Yahshua would be. But she kept them to herself. Mm-hmm. So now we go into at 30 years old, he started preaching, and he was healing the sick. And he brought people to life, and all kinds of things happened. And he started having followers. I'm not sure how he chose the followers, but maybe somebody could fill that in. But there were 12 of them. In fact, when I was in the church, I learned the song about there were 12 disciples, and you learned all their names and all that. So they followed him. And then it came to the point where it was destined to be that he would have to die for us, like Adam died for his bride. He would have to die for us, his bride. He fulfilled all the scriptures. He was on the eighth day, he was
circumcised.
Thank you. He was circumcised on the eighth day, so that meant that that was taken out of the way. Matthew 6, is it 5 and 6? I came to fulfill. Matthew 5 and 18.
5 and 18. For verily I say unto
you. 5 and 17, I'm sorry.
Okay, let me go back. Matthew 5 and 17. Think that I am not come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Okay, so who instituted the law? When he went up with Joshua, he was given these commandments, all 613. Read.
For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one yod, or the smallest part of the letter, shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments, and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven.
Okay, so he went over all these commandments, and he was there to fulfill them. And as he fulfilled them, they were brought out of the way. So everybody had to do the law. Even Yahshua had to follow the law. And so, comes to the point where he was arrested, and people were lying. They were jealous of him, the Sadducees and everything. And when they went to Pilate, he could find no fault with them, but the people insisted. They had Barabbas, a robber, I think, and then Yahshua, and they were going through the crowd saying, Yahshua, Yahshua, Yahshua. So they chose Yahshua, and he was crucified. He was in the likeness of sinful flesh, so he felt the pain. You know, he felt everything. But before that, the last thing was he had to be baptized. People thought that John the Baptist was the Messiah. And where is that about?
Matthew 3 and 13.
Matthew 3 and 13. Okay, let's go before that to Matthew 3 and 11.
I indeed immerse you with the water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall immerse you with the Holy Spirit.
Okay,
and
so
fire.
With the Holy Spirit, there's nothing in there about water anymore. Okay, read.
Whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Then cometh Joshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be immersed or baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Joshua answered, said unto him, permit it to be so, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
And there it is again, fulfill, not institute. Okay, read.
Then he permitted him. Joshua, when he was immersed, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened up unto him. And he saw the Spirit of Yahweh descending like a dove, and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
So he fulfilled the last thing, the baptism. And after that, it's out of the way. In fact, I had discussed with a person I knew was very churchy. And I showed her about the article about immersion. And that immersion is not just water. Mm-hmm. And if you look in a dictionary, it'll say immersion is baptism in Christian thing. Other than that, immersion, can somebody look up immersion? So Yahweh knew what was going to happen to him, but he was willing to sacrifice himself. That's how it had to be, the whole purpose, the fall. Adam lived 930 years, not quite a full day. Yahshua came up and fulfilled that extra seven. And so,
immersion, an act or instance of immersing, the state of being immersed, baptism in which the whole body of the person is submerged in water, also called ingress, the entrance of the heavenly body into an eclipse by another body.
Well, there must be something that's more like a Christian kind of thing. And when they explain a word within a word, you really don't understand what it means.
I have immersed.
How about baptism?
Immersed means to plunge into something that surrounds or covers, to plunge or dip into a fluid. 2, engross, absorb. 3, to baptize by immersion.
Mm-hmm. So you could be immersed, like I was immersed all week studying this, you know, and they say, pray for what you want. Well, I was praying that Yahshua would help me to say things clearly as I sit there on my sofa, you know, in good order.
To baptize, to immerse in water or sprinkle or pour water on in the Christian rite of baptism.
Okay, so I told my friend this, how it was in the dictionary that calls it the Christian rite, but it's like people that can't give up their Jesus. Mm-hmm. And even like the birth, actually the 25th, is the birth of John, because when he visited him, he was 6 months old, in Abib. So, but that's another lecture, for June 6th is actually the birthday, which is amazing, is that Dr. Keeley was also born on June 6th. Okay, let's go now to Acts 10.
There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called Italian Band, a devout man, and one that feared Elohim with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to Elohim always.
Now we heard about Cornelius before. He had a problem with one of his soldiers, and he asked Yahshua to heal him, and Yahshua said he would go with him. But he said, no, I am a commander, and when I command something, it is done, so that I know that if you command it, it will be done. And so it was done. Okay, read.
3. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of Yahweh coming in to him, and saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and saw, and said, what is it, sir? And he said unto him, thy prayers and thy alms are come up for a memorial before Elohim. And now send to Joppa, and call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter. He lodgeth with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the seaside, and he shall tell thee what thou oughtest to do. And when the angel which spake unto Cornelius was departed, he called two of his household servants, and a devout soldier of them that waited on him continually. And when he had declared all these things unto them, he sent them to Joppa. On the morrow, as they went on their journey and drew nigh unto the city, Peter went up upon the housetop to pray about the sixth hour. And he became very hungry and would have eaten, but while they made ready, he fell into a trance. And saw heaven opened, and a certain vessel descending unto him, as it had been a great sheet fastened at four corners and let down to the earth, wherein all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth, wild beasts and creepy things, and fowls of the air. And there came a voice to him, Rise, Peter, kill and eat. But Peter said, Not so, Yahweh, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean.
Okay, so when Yahshua came and fulfilled the law, that means these dietary things like you can't eat pork and you can't do this, they were out of the way. Okay, read.
And the voice spake unto him again, saying the second time, what Yahweh hath cleansed, that call not thou common? This was done priests, and the vessel was received up again into heaven. Now while Peter wondered what this vision which he had seen should mean, behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house, and stood before the gate, and called and asked whether Simon, which was surnamed Peter, were lodged there. While Peter thought unto the vision, the Spirit said unto him, behold, three men seek thee. Arise therefore, and get thee down, and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. Then Peter went down unto the men which were sent unto him from Cornelius, and said, behold, I am he whom ye seek. What is the cause wherefore ye are come?
Okay, now this is pretty long, so I won't go into all of that. But this happened at Pentecost, 50 days after Yahshua resurrected. The Holy Spirit was poured upon the Hebrews. And then, what? What?
Point to the charts.
Oh. where is it?
Well, yeah, Pentecost right there.
Oh. Pentecost. Is this here?
That's Pentecost.
Pentecost, okay. So the Holy Spirit was poured upon the uncircumcised, the circumcised, so to speak, okay? And they were not supposed to relate with the uncircumcised. So then 7 years later,
there you go.
Gentiles.
The Gentiles, keep reading.
I'm still at 21. 44. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Spirit fell on all them which heard the word. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter because of the other nationalities also was poured out the gift of the Holy Spirit. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify Yahweh. Then answered Peter.
Speaking with tongues means that they could each understand no matter what somebody was speaking. And so, where was I now? I don't know what you're pointing at.
You're pointing at the wrong plate.
Isn't this the...
No, it's not.
Over here. I can't always see when I'm up on the floor. It's like he has trouble spelling when he's on the board. Okay, so the Holy Spirit fell on all of them, but they were criticizing Peter because he was communicating with the uncircumcised. And so after they were grafted in, they thought that all of these people should be circumcised. But that was taken out of the way by Yahshua. So there's something here about that.
Am I finishing reading up the...
I want to get to the part where he's telling them about they don't have to be circumcised. Because that was taken out of the way now.
Acts 15 chapter.
Acts 15 and 1. And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. When therefore Saul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Saul and Barnabas and certain other men should go up to Jerusalem and to the apostles and the heirs about this question. And being brought on their way by the congregation, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the nations. And they caused great joy to all the brethren. They caused great joy for all the brethren. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received with the congregation and of the apostles and the elders, and declared all things that Yahweh had done with them. But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which believed, saying that it would be needful to circumcise them, and to command them to keep the law of Moses. And the apostles and the elders came together for to consider this matter. And when they had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago Yahweh made choice among us, that the nations by my mouth should hear the word of the glad tidings and believe. And Yahweh, which knoweth the hearts, and bear them witness, giving them the Holy Spirit, even as he did unto us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now therefore, why tempt ye Yahweh to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of Yahshua the Messiah, we shall be saved, even as they. Then all the multitude kept silence and gave audience to Barnabas and Saul, declaring that miracles and wonders Yahweh had wrought among the nations by them. After they had held their peace, James answered, saying, Men and brethren, hearken unto me. Simon Peter had declared how Yahweh first proposed to take out from among the nations the people of his name, and to this grace the words of the prophets, as it is written.
Okay, so it was shown that now, since all of this was fulfilled, they no longer had to do all these physical things. Well, now we are circumcised through spiritual things. And we are given the grace, which means that when we read in Romans, that grace is unmerited. So if you're doing works, the Israelites were given the law to show that you cannot by works get salvation.
That's right.
And it was only given to them. Here.
Down to 24.
What? Who said that?
I did. That was where it says that you must be circumcised. I was reading down on Acts 15 and 24, where it says, For as much as we have heard that certain which went out from us have troubled you with their words of burning your soul, saying ye must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such commandment.
No. So, when they talk about the New Testament, actually it's there too soon. Jeremiah 31:31. Because a testament is not in order until the testator is dead. So when they put New Testament and Yahshua is still running around, it is not the New Testament, mm-hmm. New Covenant. Jeremiah 31:31. Anybody?
I know, I'm going to do this Bible, so I'm taking a little long. Okay, Jeremiah 31:31.
Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt.
Read that a little bit slower.
Sorry. 31, I'll start back in the beginning. Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith Yahweh. But this shall be a covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith Yahweh. I will put my law in their inward parts, and I will write in their hearts, and will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people.
Okay, so now it will be in our inward parts. In other words, we are circumcised by getting rid of theories, concepts, opinions, and learning. All these things are spiritual sacrifices. And so what we're doing through all this is that when we start with Moses, and we learn about Dr. Kinley's charts, and John wrote Revelations, which he was told not to write in the same way as Moses because he already wrote of it. So he wrote Revelations in a different manner, but I still have trouble. Like they say, if you know Moses, you'll know John, but the writing, my carnal mind can't always translate the meanings of things. And so I need to have, I've been in class 20 years, but you know, I'm learning all the time. I've learned that you can't just go straight, as I did at first, straight to the grafting in of the Gentiles. You have to build the background, everything. You have to build the background. Start with Moses, and then start with where he started with us. And that now we are all able to have access to the Holy Spirit. And as our first saying says, to help you find and know Yahweh as He truly is and actually exists. So I hope that you got something out of this. Thank you.
Our next speaker this afternoon will be the Dean of the School, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good afternoon, class. We've got a few minutes here. I want to establish some points. What the topic is today and what we're discussing is the grafting in of the Gentiles. Mm-hmm. Now, there's a couple of things I want to make I want to make sure that is crystal clear that we all get and we understand. And that is this. It is absolutely impossible to understand this teaching with your carnal mind. It just ain't gonna happen. You see? And I want to, because she made that comment, she tried to understand this with her carnal mind. But I want to make sure I knock that in the head for everybody on the globe. There's no way to understand this gospel with a carnal mind. You see, and I'm going to tell you exactly why. Let me have Romans 8 and 6 real quickly. And let me also have I think it's Matthew 5 and 10 and 1, real quickly, I'm gonna hold that right there. Now, what we got?
Romans 8 and 6.
Now here's Romans 8 and 6. Now we over here in the present kingdom age. And we already talked about on many occasions that there are seven ages. And there's seven dispensations. And we also understand that from the fall of Adam down to, you see, the flood, that's the antediluvian age, or the age before the flood. You see, and at that particular time, there was no law, you see, and likewise, there was no Holy Spirit poured out. And the Messiah had not yet manifest on the scene. And then there's an age after flood, that's what we call it, post-diluvian age, which is the age after the flood, of course, from the flood down to the cross. You see, that ended that age. You see, after Yahshua's death and his burial and his resurrection, ascension and outpouring of the Holy Spirit in this present kingdom age. Where you and I sit right now is in this present kingdom age. That's why it says present kingdom age. You see, and that is from the Messiah's death or from the dispensing of the day of Pentecost. You see, I mean, the dispensing of the Holy Spirit, that's all the way down to where we are. So if you just look simple, real quickly at time here, we got from the fall of Adam all the way down to the cross, that is 4,000 years, you see. And we can just add on, you see, where we are in 2017, okay, you can just add that on, and that's where we are in time, you see, 6,000. 17. Okay, now that's just a brief, simple something to let you know where you are in the present kingdom age. Very simple. Now, I said all that to say this. When the Messiah was walking around on the Palestine Judean hill, you see, he was of a Hebrew lineage. What the topic is the Gentiles being grafted in.
But the Jew had to be established first. You with me so far? Mm-hmm. In order for the Jew, the Gentile, to be grafted in. Because that where the root is, you see. And also when you have roots, you're also going to have a tree that's going to branch out in branches. And then you're going to also have fruit. That makes sense? Because you want your seed to bear fruit. So here's Paul speaking in this present kingdom age. And this is what he says. Let's read.
Romans 8 and 6.
Read.
For to be carnally minded
is death. To be carnally minded is death. It's really just that simple, Doc. To be carnally minded is death. So a carnal mind means this, that you are in total darkness, you are in ignorance, or you are ignorant of Yahweh's purpose. It's really just that simple. You don't simply know. And let me tell you something. You know, when I was a kid, I didn't get it. My mother used to always say, don't be so ignorant. It was an insult to me, right? Mm-hmm. I didn't know what ignorant meant at that time. I didn't find out what ignorant mean until I got to college. It didn't make sense. I didn't know ignorant means you don't know. It's really just as simple. If you don't know, just say you don't know. You see? Now, to be ignorant is to be carnally, is being carnal minded. Now, when you're carnally minded, Paul says it's death. That means you have to be resurrected from the dead. Meaning this, when we're born into the world, right now, we are psychologically and spiritually dead. What does that mean? It means you know nothing about a Bible, you know nothing about the spirit, you know nothing about the soul, you don't know who you are, you don't know where you come from, you know nothing about your parents, you just know that you're in the world, and really, at that time, you're not even conscious of that. You don't become conscious until later on. You see? But in the meantime, you walk around in darkness, not knowing who you are, where you come from, and where you're going. Now, us being Gentiles, and sometimes when they say the word Gentile, it also means the uncircumcision. Why? Because the Jews were circumcised. You see, the Gentiles were uncircumcised. And let me say it like this. There were Gentiles who got circumcised. But Yahweh gave Israel, or the Hebrews, a law to practice circumcision. And that circumcision was to circumcise all male babies on the eighth day. You see, that was considered a circumcision. Now, sometimes, you know, when the guys used to go shake the dew off their lily, you follow what I'm saying? You see, some folks be looking over there, reckless eyeballing. They want to know, you see, if he's circumcised or he's not circumcised, which lets them know he's a Jew or he's not a, you understand, or he's a Gentile. You see, that's why it's so nice these days in the mail stalls, they got partitions there. You see, unless you reach over here and do that there, you follow what I'm saying? And you might get socked. You see, or somebody might look at you like a fool, like, what you doing, man? You get my point? They partition it off. Or you move so close that you can't see over there unless you just peek over there. You get my point? Yeah. But back in the day, they had no stalls. Nope. They just put it all out there and boom, it's out there. You know what I'm talking about? And that's, oh, he's a Hebrew or he's a Gentile. You get my point? But my point is, to be carnally minded is death, and there's a difference in a Jew and a Gentile. Now, let me establish this real quick. The Messiah, he was of a Hebrew lineage. Mm-hmm. Okay? And it was him who picked his disciples. Now, there's a difference between a disciple and an apostle. What is a disciple? The word disciple means you are a follower. It's really just that simple. You see? But an apostle means an eyewitness. Now, he picked 12 men to walk around him with him for 3.5 years. And after his death, his burial and his resurrection, you see, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, they received the Holy Spirit. That's what made them apostles, right, or eyewitnesses to the Messiah when he walked around for 3.5 years. You see, now, the Apostle Paul, he did not walk around with Messiah for 3.5 years. Why? He didn't get picked, Doc, at that particular time. Now, that's what I want to establish first since it was brought up. Now, Matthew 5:10-1. Let's read, please. Now, here's the Messiah, and she already brought this out, that John baptized the Messiah. She had that read. If not, we're not going to read it. But when he was about the age of 30, when he goes to John the Immerser or John the Baptist to get baptized in physical natural water. Why? Because the only way you can be a priest or a high priest, it starts at the age of 30. At the age of 25, you can be a low priest. So now Yahshua is 30 years old, and be mindful of the fact that Yahshua is Yahweh in a body, or the Word made flesh, or Yahshua Messiah. I said like this, or Yahweh is the mind of Yahshua Messiah, and he's carrying out the will of the Father. So therefore, it is time for him to go to the priest. And at this particular time, he's going to John the Baptist to be baptized in physical natural water. You see, so he gets baptized in water. Now he's entering into his ministry on the earth plane, because the creation of the whole universe is what we call the greater and more perfect tabernacle, you see, which he's officiating in. So he gets baptized by John. Now he goes and picks his 12. Let's read, please. Matthew 10:1. Let's go.
And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits.
He didn't call them apostles, did he? He called them disciples. You got to understand that. Let's read, please.
To cast them out.
Read on.
And to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease.
So he got his posse together. This is what they're going to do. Let's read.
The names of the 12 apostles.
Now he's going to declare them right now. Read.
The first, Simon. Who was called Peter.
Read on.
And Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip, and
Bartholomew,
Thomas, and Matthew, the publican, James, the son of Alphi, and Lebeus, whose surname was Thaddeus. Simon the Zealot, and Judah
Iscariot,
who also betrayed him. These 12 Yahshua sent forth.
Now he says, these 12, the Messiah, or Yahshua, sent forth. Read on.
And commanded them.
Read on.
Saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles.
Wait a minute. Don't go talking to no doggone Gentiles. The uncircumcision, the heathens, the nations. Don't go talking to them. He made that perfectly clear. Don't be hanging out with no Gentile personage. Don't be messing with those Gentile women, and don't be messing with them Gentile men. You understand what I'm saying? Yahweh told him that long time ago, and now Yahshua's telling him again. You go preach to your own. You see, you talk to the Jews first, because it ain't time for me to bring no Gentiles in. However, Yahweh made provisions, you with me, for all the families of the nation through Abraham, when he gave the Abrahamic promise. What is the promise? That he's going to bless all families of the nation, both Jew and Gentiles. That include us. However, at the time, we did not know that, anything about the doggone promise, because the promise was made to Abraham, who was the very first Hebrew. And the word Hebrew means he who comes from the other side of the river. And it was Yahweh that told Abraham, you see, to cross the river, you see, and I would say like this, he sanctified him. He told him, go across the river, you see, and he told him that he's going to give him a land, you see, and he's going to bless that land. He said, hey, listen, this is what they call the promised land, you see. And listen, Abraham walked length and breadth of Canaan's land, which is the promised land, but he never saw the inheritance, or never received the promise at that particular time. He received the promise way down here, but he did not receive the promise at that particular time. Nevertheless, the promise was made to Abraham to bless all the families of the nation, both Jew and Gentile. And this is what he said. He's going to multiply his seed, listen, singular, as the stars of heaven and as the sands of the sea. That was the promise. But it didn't say just bless the Jews. He said going to bless all the families of the nation. Listen, both Jew and Gentile, or Jew, or the circumcision and the uncircumcision. Is everybody with me? Keep reading, son.
And into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not.
This is what you don't go to them either. Don't go to the Samaritans. Don't go to the Gentiles. Let's read.
But rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Well, listen here. We lost too. Mm-hmm. He said them to them, but we lost too. Mm-hmm. You know how somebody said, what about me? You see, but Yahweh already made provision for us. Let's read, please.
And as ye go, preach.
He said, as you go, you preach and you teach. Read on.
Say, repent ye. Repent ye.
Now you just stop right there. What does the word repent mean? It means to make an about face. Mm-hmm. If you was a gangster, you probably wasn't raised a gangster. Mm-hmm. You see, if you're I don't want to say that, but I'm going to say it anyway. You know how some of these kids are just sassy? Mm-hmm. You see, disrespectful and just rude when they get grown because they found out that they're 18 years old. And they go, when I announce you, I'm 18. Like, so what? You're still a dependent. Talking about you 18. Yeah, you can buy cigarettes. You see, can't buy alcohol. Yeah, you can go to jail now. But you can't make no, you get one phone call, they ain't gonna slap your hand, call your mama to come get you. You get my point? I'm 18. But I'm still buying your Fruit of the Looms. You see, you get my point? You see, let's read on, please.
For the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
He said the kingdom of heaven is right now. Read on.
Heal the sick.
Now this is what they don't do. Heal the sick. Come on.
Cleanse the leper.
That's the diseased. Read on.
Raise the dead.
Cast out the demons. Read on.
Freely ye have received.
Freely you have received this gift. Come on.
Freely give.
And freely give. That's why we ain't in here begging for no money. Well, see, our donations in this school are free will donations. Nobody pass a plate. You see? Nobody gonna twist your arm to get a couple of pennies out of you. You either give it or you don't. Don't nobody down here get paid. You see? And if anybody get paid, I know he and myself would love to get paid if they be giving out paychecks down here. You get my point? But no, this gospel does not cost money. You see, it ain't cost you no money, it ain't cost no him no money to give it. You get my point? So, we gotta have lights. This camera wears out. This is our third, fourth. We wore our camera. You see, we gotta buy discs, we gotta buy papers, and we gotta buy toilet paper. You get, we have things, we got utilities. You see, and we also, we have domestic things we need on a daily basis. So that's why we donate. No other reason, all right? But read on, please.
Provide neither gold nor silver.
Hey, we giving out no cash. You see, ain't no money. We giving out no, not that either. Read on.
Nor brass in your purses.
Read on.
Nor script in your journal.
Come on.
Neither two coats, neither shoes, nor yet staves.
Read.
Nor the workman is worthy of his food.
Okay, this is good enough. I made my point. Now, one more point I want to make while we make that. He said, don't go to the Gentiles. You go to the lost sheep of the Jews. Now, Yahweh is letting you know there's a difference between the two. Yet there isn't. Now, Mark 13:11. Also, I want you to pick up Matthew.
Ooh, where is it at? How about 6 and
maybe 13. I think that's what I want. I think it's 6 and 13.
You want Mark 13 first?
Yeah. Now, see, now I want this said for this reason. He also told them what they're going to do. They're going to heal the sick, call the blind, and see the deaf to speak. That's the power that he gave them. All right? Now, this is another thing that he said when they went out. Read.
Mark 13 and what verse?
11.
Okay.
Now, the reason why I'm having this read, we down here, we don't know what the heck we're going to say when we get up here. We don't have a prepared text. You see, now we down here, we are a research organization. What does that mean? We're going back and we are researching or reviewing the record of 6,000 years of history. You follow what I'm saying? To get an understanding of Yahweh's divine purpose and his pattern, his plan. You see? So, this is a research organization, as the moderator said, dedicated to showing the proof and the existence of Yahweh our Elohim, because we don't know him. We know what people say. We know what we heard. You see? We heard all the conversation, but it's to show, it's a research organization to show dedicated to showing the proven existence of Yahweh our Elohim, operating throughout the dispensations and ages. That's what we're about down here. All right. Now, this is what Yahshua told them to do. Read on.
But when they shall lead you and deliver you up,
read.
Take no anxious thought beforehand what ye shall speak.
Don't try to figure out what you're gonna say. Read on, please.
Neither do you premeditate.
Don't either premeditate. That's why I don't like knowing what I'm gonna talk about sometimes. Y'all think about it all day, all week long. Get butterflies in my stomach. You know what I'm talking about? But the point is, take no anxious thought to what you might say. Read on.
But whatsoever shall be given you,
read,
in that hour,
read,
that speak ye,
read,
for it is not ye that speak.
It ain't your carnal mind talking.
But,
you get my point? Read.
But the Holy Spirit.
But the Holy Spirit. See, what you want to do, we're trying to knock your concepts and your theories in the head. Because we know simply, you don't know. But if you try to understand this gospel with a carnal mind, I'm letting you know it ain't going to happen for this very reason. He was not carnal. He was in the likeness of sinful flesh. He appeared to be set flesh. He was not human like you and me. You see, he appeared to be human. He had the same desires, the same feelings that you have. But the difference is, his parents, you see, were not carnal and they were not physical. You see, and let me say this, even though he lived under the dispensation of the law, he fulfilled every tenet of the law. You see, why? Because there's a purpose in operation and there's a pattern in operation. Now, go to Matthew, what I called over there, I think it's 6 and 13. I think that's what I want.
Matthew 6:13.
I think.
And lead us away from temptation and deliver us from evil.
That ain't it. I tell you what I want. Just a second. 6:31. That's what I want. Take no anxious thought to what you say, and when he said them out, this is another thing he said. Read, please.
6:31.
Read.
So the demons besought him, saying, if thou cast us out, permit us to go away into the herd of swine. And he said,
therefore take no anxious thought to what you may say. That's why when you get up here, you just let Yahweh take over and let you say what you need to say. But don't try to think about what you're going to say. Just let him say. He may send you one direction, then he may send you in another. Alright? But let's read on. But take no anxious thought to what you might say. Read.
What shall we eat?
Look. When I send you out, we worry about what you're going to eat. Not like we ain't missing no meals up in here, but read on, please.
Or,
read.
What shall we drink?
What shall we drink? Read on.
Or, wherewithal shall we be clothed?
Read on.
For all these things do the pagans seek.
Wait. All these things do what?
For after all these things do the pagans seek.
Who are the pagans? Well, that's us, folks. The Gentiles. The pagans seek these things. You know, we want to make sure we look all suave and everything. You see, we want to present well. You see, but you Jews, you guys hold to the law. Because the pagans eat pork. Don't you eat no pork? And that pork tastes good too. You know what I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm.
But you better not be touching no pork or no hoofed animal. You get my point? They had a law they had to adhere to. But the Edens, they can party and do whatever they want. And I'm going to tell you right now, the Corinthians, it was a place, they loved the party. It was a place like Las Vegas. And Paul went there too. Read on, please. I'm almost done with this. Read.
For the Heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of these things, of all these
things. So Yahweh know what you need. So don't be worried about it, and Yahweh will provide. That's why we say, seek ye the kingdom, and everything else we've given unto you. Let's read on, please.
But seek ye first the kingdom of Yahweh and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you.
Now that's good enough right there. I just want to throw that out because that's what he told them, and that's what we're telling you. You get my point? No different. Don't worry about it. Yahweh will provide. And everybody in this room had an invitation at some point in time to come walking through their doors. And everybody in the class, I'm talking about from coast to coast on the globe, they had a personal invitation direct from Yahweh or an invite. And that's the only reason why we're here. No other reason. Now we got that out the way. Pick up Hebrews. I want the first chapter, 8:1. Now, there's a pattern that is in operation. And everything is also going by a pattern. You see, and also, what you're getting at, I want you to also pick up Genesis, the 12th chapter, because I want to establish what Yahweh set up. You know what? I ain't got time for that. We already talked about the problem with Abraham being the promise, right? Mm-hmm. You see, and one thing I want to say about Abraham was the first one, or the first man, to practice monotheism. What does that mean? That there's only one God. He was the first man to practice that. Now these heathens, or these Hebrews, or the uncircumcised, or the Gentiles, being nice, or the nations, that they called all those different things, sometimes they're called the strangers. So when you're reading your Bible, you see things, and a stranger, that's a Gentile. Or the nations, that's a Gentile. Or it's talking about the uncircumcised, or circumcision, that's a Gentile. You see, you get my point? Understand that when you're reading, he's talking about Gentiles. All right? Let's read, please.
Hebrews 8:1.
Please. And I want you to pick up 1 Kings 18:1-21.
Now the things we have spoken this in the sun.
What? Read that again.
Now of the things which we have spoken this in the sun, we have such a high priest.
Wait a minute. Is that what that says?
Hebrews 8:1.
Now the things which you have spoken, this is the
sign. I thought that's what it said. Go ahead, read on. So, go ahead and read it now.
Okay.
But Lita, add the word to it, please.
Now the things which we have spoken, this is the sign.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that. Read on, please.
We have such a high priest.
Read on.
Who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty.
Talking about the Messiah, read on.
In the heavens.
Mm-hmm.
A minister of the sanctuary.
Read on.
And of the true tabernacle.
Of the true tabernacle, which is him.
Which Yahweh pitched. And not the man.
Read on.
For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices.
Now listen, Josh, this is the high priest of high priests. Talking about Yahweh Elohim. Read on, please.
Wherefore, it is of a necessity that this man have somewhat also to offer.
Read.
For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest.
Read.
Seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law.
Come on.
Who serve unto the example and shadows of heavenly things.
Read on.
As Moses was
admonished come on.
Of Elohim when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount.
Now, the pattern that he's talking about is this tabernacle pattern here, you see, which the moderator alluded to. Now, this tabernacle have a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. It's important that we understand these basic principles of the pattern. You see, and also there are 7 steps to this tabernacle. We got the most holy place, the holy place, and the court roundabout, which is a principle of 3, and that the tabernacle is threefold. We got 7 steps to our pattern, or the tabernacle, with the gate being 1. You see, you have to enter into the tabernacle. And then the altar of sin sacrifice, you see, is the 2nd step in your pattern. This is where they would offer up the sacrifice, but they would also pick the blood of the sacrifice and put it on the 4 corners, you see, of the horns, you see, because this altar represents the earth, you see. It also had a grave on it, you see, which they would place the animal on, and that animal or that sacrifice would be consumed. And what it does, it actually points to the earth plane in itself in this respect, in that you have the earth. You see, and you have longitude, right?
Can you find it? Can you use a black one? Because it's not really showing up that well.
Okay.
It's a black one.
I go check my pockets. I'd be taking. I'd go look up, and then next time, some of them are at home. You know what I mean? I gotta bring them back. You see here? Longitude and latitude. In other words, the Earth is likened to a grave. You see, which we're standing on, which we are that sacrifice. You see what I'm saying? So therefore, just mankind's on four corners of the Earth. They have to put the blood on the four horns of the altar. That is your second step in your pattern. Then you have a washing taking place in our breathing labor. You see, the high priest would wash the animal, but the high priest would also wash himself. You see, and then there's a cup of holy anointing on, which symbolizes spirit, because oil symbolizes spirit, you see, which is actually at the door. And the door itself is your fourth step, you see, in your pattern. What are you talking about? You see, I'm trying to get you to see that there's a pattern operation in everything in the universe, no matter what it is moving by this pattern. You see, so the door, you see, is the entranceway into the holy place where there's, that is the fifth step, you see, or the fifth in your pattern here. Now, there is a, this door is actually this veil. This veil is blue, purple, and scarlet, you see, and inside the holy place, which is the fifth step, there's a seven-branched golden lampstand, there's a table of showbread, and also the altar of incense. Now, the high priest would take the oil, you see, and in the morning at 9 o'clock, you see, he would snuff out the lampstand because the tabernacle could never at any time be in darkness. He would take the oil and he would fill it into the fourth branch, and it would fill all these prongs or the candlesticks evenly because the Messiah, you see, manifested in the airplane, that is, in the 4,000 year. You see, and it was him, you see, that's going to illuminate the whole world. He was going to be able to pick up Adam, and also, he also going to pick us up on this side of the cross. Nevertheless, that is the seven-branch golden lampstand. There's a table of showbread, you see, where there are 12 loaves of bread, six on one side and six on the other. It was a four-sided structure, you see, just like you have a four-chambered heart, you see. But there was a sustenance which the high priest would eat of and partake of. It was the low priest that would prepare, you see, would officiate and prepare the bread and all that stuff. Then you have the altar of incense, you see, which is a five-sided structure. It looks like it's four-sided, but it's a five-sided structure because it points, of course, to your lungs, which you have five lobes. So there's a five-sided structure here. But we like to narrow this down to light, bread, and intercessor, because what the incense is likened to, what it would do, it would waft up, you see, into the most holy place, to prevent the smell or the stench of these animals that's burning down here on this altar. But that's the altar of incense. And it would perfume the entire tabernacle, you see, to prevent that stench. Just like in your body, you have lungs or you have air, you see, but Yahweh is capable of perfuming your body so you don't smell the stench of the cows and the pigs and the chickens that you eat. You get my point? Now, coming on in here, on above here, higher here, I mean, in the next step, you see, is your second departmental veil, you see, which is your sixth step. So we got the gate one, the altar sin sacrifice two, the labor three, and the doors four, with a cup of holy anointing oil is at the door. You see, the holy place and all its contents is the fifth step, where you have the light, the bread, and the intercessor, and then your sixth step is your second departmental veil, which we have it parted so you can see what's inside, but actually it is blocked, where you cannot see in. Now, that's what the Ark of the Covenant would be, of course, your seventh step in your pattern. But this veil is also blue, purple, and scarlet, likened to your first veil, which is blue, purple, and scarlet. Now, the most holy place has the Ark of the Covenant, you see, where there's two archangels standing on the mercy seat. And this is one beaten piece of pure gold, okay? And they also had a lid here, you see, in front of the Ark of the Covenant, whereby you can open it, and they were placed in there. You see, Aaron's rod and budded, a pot of manna, and the two tables of stone was placed inside of the Ark of the Covenant, or the mercy seat, if you will. Now, Michael is a warrior, Gabriel is a messenger, and in the midst, there was a cloud that Yahweh set on, where the eyes, all seeing eye, you see, you would manifest, or the Shekinah would flash, you see, when the high priest would come in on the Day of Atonement and perform the service. What am I talking about? I'm trying to get you to see that this pattern, You see, you're going to place on each one of these charts, you're going to also place it on yourself, but you're going to also see the workings of the purpose and plan of Yahweh, you see, all the way down through the dispensations and ages. You see, and the pattern here we're looking at, there's a principle of death, which is blood. There's also a principle of water right here, which is a burial. And there's also a principle of spirit, you see, which the high priest would pour that oil on himself once in order for him to officiate in the holy place and the most holy place. Just like when you're born, you see, the spirit takes up residence in your body just once as you can walk around on the earth plane. But there's a principle of death, burial, and resurrection of blood, water, and spirit. You see, but it's the high priest who's functioning in and out of the tabernacle. Are you with me so far? Mm-hmm. Now, let's deal with these doggone Gentiles and these Jews. 1 Kings 18 and 21. Now, this is Elijah, you see, the Yahweh. Now, let me tell you something. Elijah did not write a book, all right? But Yahweh chose Elijah to carry out his purpose. All right, and this is one of the things he talked about, because he believed in monotheism, which is one God. Because the Gentiles or the heathens, they believe in a whole bunch of God, to the point they say, hey, guess what? They would mock. You guys only got one God? You see, down here we got several gods. We got 20 gods, 30 gods, 100 gods. You get my point? And you guys only got one God? My God, what kind of people are you guys with only one God? You get my point? Those were the heathens or the Gentiles. But let me say this. I brought up the tabernacle for this reason. The Gentiles, they did not have a pattern. They did not have the tabernacle. They were never given a law. You see? So therefore, they didn't know anything about this tabernacle pattern. Let me prove that before you read 1 Kings. Romans 2:14. Quickly,
Romans 2:14.
Read on.
For when the Gentiles, which had not the law, do by nature the things contained in the law, these, having not the law, are a law unto themselves.
Read on.
Which show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, and their thoughts, the meanwhile accusing or else excusing one another.
That's good enough right there. So the Gentiles didn't have the 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances, but the Jews did. And the Gentiles did not have to practice these different rituals and ceremonies on a regular basis. You follow me? So that's why there's a separation between the circumcision and the uncircumcision, or the Jew and the Gentile, or the Hebrew and, of course, the heathen. Y'all with me so far? Mm-hmm. Now, here's an example of that. Because I went through the pattern to show you how that the Messiah came in in the 4,000 year or in the fourth millennium, you see, 4,000 years after Adam. You see, but we're going to look at some principles under the dispensation of law to see how he's carrying out the works of the pattern. All right? Read on, please.
In Romans, or am I going back to...
Kings. We drew it Romans. I made my point.
Second Kings.
No, 18, not Second Kings.
First Kings. First Kings.
I think it's second. Yeah.
18 and 22.
1.
21. And Elijah came unto all the people and said,
read.
How long... How thou between two opinions.
Read on. What opinions are that? Are you going to worship Yahweh in spirit and truth? Or are you going to hold on to all your idols? Because you know how we are. Something sounds good, and we flow with that. This sound good, and we flow with that. And this sound good, and we flow with that. We just flow on with anything that sound good and look good. Now, what most people do, they got this great big edifice. I'm talking about the church. You see? Nice robes and everything, you see? And they sing good, and I'm gonna tell you something, I love good singing, you see? And they got all this pomp and circumstances and so on, and folks see that and they feel good because the music sound good and everything, and they say, I'm gonna go there, and they show, you get my point? But when you come out, they have no knowledge. They don't know nothing about Yahweh. They don't know nothing about the Bible. They don't know nothing about spirit. They don't know what the soul is. They don't know nothing about they don't even know nothing about an old covenant or a new covenant or an old testament or a new testament. They don't know nothing about that. They don't even know why he's on this cross, other than what so-and-so tell you. But you hold our feet to the fire. You make sure we prove it to you to your satisfaction. Now read, please.
And Elijah came to all the people and said,
read.
How long halt ye between two opinions?
Read on.
If Yahweh be Elohim, follow him.
Read on.
If Baal, then follow him.
Now, Baal, for our new ones, Baal, translated, means, what it means, folks?
Lord.
It means lords. That's what Baal means. Now, you follow Baal, or you follow Yahweh. Read on, please.
And the people answered him not a word.
But what, it didn't say nothing. Come on.
Then said Elijah.
Read.
Elijah read. Unto the people, I, even I only, remain a prophet of Yahweh.
Read on.
But Baal's prophets are 450 men.
Now they have 450 idols. But I, alone by myself, I worship Yahweh. You see? Let's read.
Let them therefore give us two bullocks.
Read it. Now you're going to take two bullocks, two young bullocks. You see, come on.
And let them choose one bullock for themselves.
Uh-huh.
And cut it in pieces.
Read.
And lay it on the wood.
Read on.
And put no fire under.
So we're going to offer up a sacrifice. All right. Now we already talked about, you see, there's a sacrifice that was put on this altar right here, right? Yes. And this animal had to be consumed. Now, here Elijah, he set this thing up back here. He said, we're going to take two bullocks, and you're going to put it on the altar without any fire. You see, because you got 450, you see, Elohims or idols, but I got my little one Yahweh. I want to show you how mighty he is versus your 450. Let's read, please.
And I will dress the other bullock and lay it on wood.
Read.
And put no fire under.
Read on.
And call ye on the name of your idol.
Read on.
And I will call on the name of Yahweh.
Uh-huh. Read it.
And the one that answereth with fire, let him be Elohim.
Now that sounds like it's fair, right? Didn't that sound fair? The one that light the fire, so you know we're going to flow with him. And the one that don't light the fire, guess what? You exposed. Why did you tell a lie? Nah. Mm-hmm. Somebody kept you in the lie. Now you're trying to figure out a way to cover it up. You exposed. Just come on clean with it at this point. And then you want to try a way to justify it and try to fix it. To, you know, we call it rationalizing. Fix it in your mind and make it right so you can understand why I did it. I ain't going to say what I really want to say, but just come clean. Read on, please.
And all the people answered and said,
read.
It is well spoken.
We can flow with that. Let's read.
And Elijah said unto the prophets of Baal,
uh-huh.
Choose you one bullock for yourself,
uh-huh.
And dress it first,
read.
For ye are many, and call on the name of your idol, and put no fire under.
Now this is what he said. Oh man, you see how Yahweh do us. They want to change the article. They want to delete article 19. You see, and then, you see, they found out they can't do it. By law. Talking about the Constitution. Now, what they want to do, we got all these schools, you see, everybody at school, all the schools got a vote, but now it's only one vote per school. So whatever your school agree with, that's considered one vote. You get my point?
Yeah.
So now, you got 450 idols. Now you can have an idol for each one of the 450. You're going to choose one idol to represent all 450. Y'all with me so far? Let's move. Come on.
And they took the bullock which was given them.
Read.
And they dressed it.
Uh-huh.
And called on the name of Baal.
Read.
From the morning until the evening.
So this Baal represented all of them. Read on.
From the morning even until the noon.
Read on.
Saying, O Baal, hear us.
Read.
But there was no voice.
Read on.
Nor any that answered.
Come on.
And they leaped upon the altar
Come
which
on.
Was made.
Mm-hmm.
And it came to pass at noon that Elijah mocked them and said.
Now listen, this has been going all day. All right? Now you guys know, and Will talked about this last week. The Hebrew day starts at what time? 6 o'clock in the morning. That's the first day of the hour, or the first hour of the day. And he also had it drawn out how that, didn't Messiah say, isn't there but 12 hours in a day? You see, so they're going on from 6 o'clock until noon. Doc, that's 6 hours. they're out there waiting for this thing to happen. So now Elijah said, y'all done had 6 hours. He said, now let me get involved in this. Read on, please.
Cry aloud.
Read.
For he is a mighty one.
Go back and pick that up.
And it came to pass at noon that Elijah mocked them and
read.
Said, cry aloud.
Y'all scream a little louder, come on.
For he is a mighty one.
He's a mighty Baal, come on.
Either he is talking.
Read.
Or he is pursuing, or he is in a journey, or peradventure he sleepeth and must be awake.
In other words, all your gods, you see, they're not answering your voice. You see, even have a conversation with his friend, or he's watching SpongeBob or something like that. You get my point? But one thing for sure, he ain't listening to y'all. Let's read on. So scream a little louder so he'll help y'all out. Read, please.
And they cried aloud.
Oh, they listen to Paul, too. And they start screaming. You see, read on, please.
And cut themselves after their manner with knives and lances.
Because they were serious about their 450 gods. Come on, read.
Till the blood gushed out upon them.
Read on. Now, you know, blood don't last for a little while now. You're going to bleed out.
And it came to pass.
Read.
When midday was past.
Read on.
And they raved on until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice.
Now see, we got a fact. What time was the evening sacrifice? Anybody?
3 o'clock.
He let that go on for 3 hours later. For the evening sacrifice. There's a morning sacrifice and the evening. Now there's 9 hours of raving acting a damn fool. Calling on 450 bells or gods. Or idols, they represent it. Let's read, please. Come on.
And as they raved on until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, there was neither voice nor any to answer, nor any that regarded.
In other words, those 450 gods, you follow me? That the Gentiles were holding on to, they did not show up and they did not answer. All right? Now let's read, please.
And Elijah said unto all the people.
Now y'all folks. Y'all gather around. Come on around here. Read on.
Come near unto me.
Come on over here. Read on. Ain't but one of me. Come on.
And all the people came near unto
him. And listen, you know, now they saw the show, right? So here they show up. Come on.
And he repaired the altar of Yahweh that was broken down.
Go ahead.
And Elijah took 12 stones.
Now listen, folks. He took 12 stones. We talked about the pattern, right? You see, how many disciples were there? How many tribes back here in the wilderness? So he took what? 12 what? Stones. You see, because we got a pattern, we are right. We want you to know we know what we're talking about down here. Let's read, please.
And Elijah took 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob,
come on.
Unto whom the word of Yahweh came,
read.
Saying, Israel shall be thy name.
Read on.
And with the stones he built an altar in the name of Yahweh.
Now we talked about the altar on your pattern right here. I want you to let you know that everything is going by pattern. You see? Let's read on.
And he made a trench about the altar.
Now let me say this before I move on. I'm kind of deviating a little bit, kind of weave a few things in. You see, this altar points to your digestive tract. You see? And we got this right here on our pattern. You see how that in your digestive tract, you have four concentrations of arteries and veins. You got an ascending, a transverse, and a descending, and a sigmoid colon. And there is a constant, listen, you see, oxidation going on in your colon. In other words, when you put some food in your stomach, I'm letting you know it got to break down to the point that it's just able to absorb the nutrients out of the food that you put in. You see, and the waste products, of course, as you know, it just pass right on out. You say, well, it ain't no benefit to you. It's not like you're going to look at it and go get it. You follow what I'm saying? But the point is, there's a consuming of that food down here in the heart, and there's some absorption going on in your body. Likewise, just as your food has to be consumed, you see, likewise, that animal had to be consumed on this sacrifice. So Elijah, he put the bullock on the altar. Let's read, please.
And he made a trench about the altar.
He made a trench. He digged a hole, Doc. You see, read on, please.
About the altar,
read.
As great as wood contained
read.
2 measures of seed.
Read on.
And he put the wood in the order, and cut the bullock in pieces,
read.
And laid him on the wood, and said, fill full barrels with water, and pour it on the burnt sacrifice.
Now wait a minute. We got an altar. Now we got some water. Gotta come up with, gotta have some water. Because we got a pattern. Let's read. Mm-hmm.
and on the wood.
Read
and poured it over the burnt sacrifice and the wood.
Read.
And he said, do it the second time.
Now listen. Elijah's cold. He said, not only am I going to put the wood, I'm going to take some water, I'm going to pour the water over the wood.
Wet.
Make sure it's nice and good and wet. Soaked, as he would say here. Read, please.
And they did it the second time.
Uh-oh! He did it a second time. We got a pattern here. Read on.
And he said,
come on.
Do it a third time.
Do it a third time. Now, why is he saying that? We know Yahweh is threefold, right? And listen, Doc, we got a pattern, that right? How many times did the high priest go into the most holy place on the Day of Atonement?
Three times.
You see, first for the heirs of himself, then for the heirs of the people, and then for the cleanse of the sanctuary. How many times did Moses go up into the mountain?
Three times.
First he had to go up there, and Yahweh told him to kill the people, gather them, go speak to them. Then it was brought out today, and she brought out, he went up there to get the table of stone to bring them back down, and then he went up, caught them up because he broke these, he went back up again to get the second table of stone and bring them and put them in the Ark of the Covenant. You get my point? 3 times, because we got a pattern. Let's read.
And they did it a third time.
And they did it the third time. Come on.
And the water ran around the
altar. Oh, wait a minute. I thought it made me mad. One more thing. How many times did Messiah go up into the mountain?
3 times.
3 times. You see? So we got a pattern. And we talked about this also. When he was praying, how many times did he come out in that 1 hour?
3 times.
The pattern is operation. Let's read, please.
And the water ran about the altar. And he filled the trench also with water.
Read on.
And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Yahweh, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art Elohim of Israel.
Now hold it right there. I want to make sure this is clear. He said he's the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. Israel, his real name, his first name, was Jacob. His name was changed from Jacob to Israel. You see, that's why he said it that way. And Jacob had 12 sons, or Israel had 12 sons. That's why they're called the descendants of Jacob, or the sons of Jacob, or they're called the Israelites, because the descendants of Jacob. You see, now listen, it was Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who was the root. You see, they established the foundation. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And they all came down through that lineage. You see? Read on, please.
Thou art Elohim in Israel, and that I am thy servant.
Come on.
And that I have done all these things at thy word.
Read.
Hear me, O Yahweh, hear me, that this people may know that thou art Yahweh Elohim.
Read on.
And that thou hast turned their heart back again.
Read on.
Then the fire of Yahweh fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice.
Now look, the fire of Yahweh fell and consumed the sacrifice. Read on.
And the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up the water that was in the tree.
Now we're talking about a Yahweh that know how to deliver. He's going to convince these people. Let's read.
And when all the people saw it,
read.
They fell on their faces.
Look, embarrassed. They were exposed, chasing after idols, and they didn't realize Yahweh was right there among them the whole time. Let's read, please.
And they said, Yahweh, he is the Elohim.
And so they acknowledged it. Read on.
Yahweh, he is the Elohim.
Read on.
And Elijah said unto them,
read.
Take the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape.
Hey, y'all
come on over here. Y'all
get over here. I can't be as blunt as I want to be right now, but y'all get y'all a honey right on over here. You see, because I got provisions for you. You're going to put me on blast. I'm going to put you on blast. Let's read, please.
And they took them.
He took them.
And Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and slew them there.
Killed their butts. They deserve to die. And that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to get rid of that carnality, that carnal mind. Now, this is why the people were that way. Deuteronomy 31. And, oh my gosh, is it 31? I think. This is why they're this way. And pick up Romans. The scripture lesson real quick. I ain't got time to read it all, but I'm going to get it. Deuteronomy 31, I think it's 31.
31.
I'll tell you exactly where it is.
There you go, 31.
30.
No, no, no. I apologize. There is, I want Deuteronomy 31 and...
21.
No, 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 no. That's too far down.
20.
Start at 18. Start at 17, we'll read down. We'll have enough time to get through that.
17, then yeah. My anger shall be kindled against them in that day, and I will forsake them, and I will hide my face from them.
I apologize. Start at 15.
And Yahweh appeared in the tent in a pillar of a cloud.
Yes.
And the pillar of the cloud stood over the door of the tent.
Read, talking about, right here, read on. This
and
one.
Yahweh said unto Moses, behold, thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, and this people will rise up and go whoring after the deities of strangers of the land.
Y'all know what that means. I ain't got to explain that, do I? Mm-hmm. Right, right, right. All right, read on. And over, he's talking about Israel's offspring, the Jews, the Hebrews. They're going to go chasing after those doggone idols. That's why we got the Seventh-day Adventists, the Episcopalians, the Presbyterians, the Roman Catholics, Baptists, you get my Lutheranism, Calvinism, you gotta get my point? Read on, please.
Whether they go to be among them,
read,
and will forsake me,
read,
and break my covenant,
uh-huh,
which I have made with them.
Come on, read on.
Then my anger
I'm
shall
showing
be
you
kindled.
The state condition of these people, the minds of the people. You see, it's just earthly, it's carnal. You see, and we're trying to get rid of that. You see, read on, please.
Then my anger shall be kindled against them.
In other words,
that
I'm
day.
Gonna so be mad at them I can eat nails, I wanna kill them. But it can't kill him. You see, I mean, you really don't want to kill your wife. She makes you feel like you want to kill her. But you can't kill her for two reasons. One, you love her, and then you take responsibility for her, and then you want to take care of her. But she makes you so damn mad, it's like you want to pull your hair off, if that is, if you got some. You see, and then, and let me let you know right now, these folks right here made him so damn mad, on many occasions he wanted to kill Israel, because they are disobedient people. Let's read, please, come on.
My anger shall be kindled against them in that day, and I will forsake them, and I will hide my face from them.
In other words, you know what they're going to call on me? You know how somebody make you mad over and over, you know what? You're just going to let them waddle in their own little vomit, own little mess they made. You see, it's like Kenaway said today. Hey, tickle me to death. She said, she said, hurry up now. Like, read down, slow down a little bit. Don't reread so doggone fast. You know, she reads fast. She said, hey, slow down, read that again. Or, hey, wait a minute, hey, are y'all back there? Y'all scripture readers? Read on, please. Just joking with you, read.
And they shall be devoured.
Read on.
And many evils and troubles shall befall them.
Come on.
So that they will say in that day,
read.
Are not these evils come upon us?
Come on.
Because of our Elohim
come on.
Among us?
Read on.
And I will surely hide my face in that day for all the evils which they shall have wrought, in that they are turned unto idols.
Read on.
Now
we just read about that, right? Now we in the law. Whatever's written in the law is confirmed by the prophets. Isn't that what we teach down here? So we'll try to get you to see. Whatever you read from Joshua down to Malachi, you can go back to the law and find it. So now we back in the law, showing you why they act and behave in the way they did. It was already prophesied it's going to happen. Let's read, please.
Now therefore, write ye this psalm for you.
Read on.
And teach it the children of Israel.
Read on.
Put it in their mouths, that this song may be a witness for me against the children of Israel.
Read on.
For when I shall have brought them into the land which I swear
read.
Unto their fathers.
Talking about Canaan's land. Read on.
That floweth with milk and honey.
Read on.
And they shall have eaten and filled themselves and waxen fat. Then will they turn unto idols and serve them and provoke me and break my covenant.
Now you know how we say, I ain't gonna do that. I ain't gonna never do that. Read on, please.
And it shall come to pass,
read,
when many evils and troubles are befallen them,
read,
that this song shall testify read. Against them as a witness.
So I'm going to teach them this song. And after I teach them the song, when it happens, they'll know it's a witness against them. Remember he told Peter, he said, you're going to deny me three times when the cock crow, right? And when Peter said, oh, no, I ain't going to do that. But let me tell you something. When that cock started crowing, he was crying like a baby, am I right? Because he denied him three times.
Yeah.
All right, let's read. If he declared it's going to come to pass after this law. Let's read, because I got to hurry and get out of here. Read on.
For it shall pass, not be forgotten out
read.
Of the mouths of their seed.
Read.
For I know their imagination
read.
Which they go about.
The thoughts, concepts, and opinions in their head. Read on.
Even now,
before I have brought them into the land which I swear.
Read up.
Moses therefore wrote this song the same day.
So he wrote the song and he taught the people the song. Read on, please.
And he gave Joshua the son of Nun a charge.
Read on.
And said, be strong and be of good courage, for thou shalt bring the children of Israel into the land which I swear unto them.
Read on.
And I will be with thee.
See, Moses is ready to check out. No, he's ready to die. All right? I'll say it like that. He's already died. He buried in Mount Nebo. And then Joshua, the son of Nun, who is Yahweh manifest in the flesh, to carry them all over in the Canaan land. That's what he's talking about right now. Because Deuteronomy means to rehearse. And he's giving them the history of what happened, what's going on with these people, and what's going to happen to them. But let's read on, please.
And it came to pass, when Moses had made an end of writing the words of this law in a book, until they were finished.
Read, please.
That Moses commanded the Levites, which bear the ark of the covenant of Yahweh, saying,
read.
Take this book of the law and put it in the side of the ark of the covenant of Yahweh, your Elohim, that it may be there for a witness against thee.
Now watch this part. We're going to get out of here. Read.
For I know thy rebellion and thy stiff neck. Behold, while I am yet alive with you.
In other words, I know how these people are. They're stiff necked and they rebellion and they are hard headed. Read, please.
Ye have been rebellious against Yahweh and have much more after my death.
Read on. In other words, wait. He said, now, they act a damn fool down here in Egypt. They act a damn fool down here in the wilderness of Sinai. And Moses said, after I die, when you take them over, I'm letting you know, when you die, they're going to act a bigger fool than that. You see, and as the founder said, guess what? You see, my gospel, they ain't going to preach it the same way once I die. He said, I'm letting you know, they're going to change it. And somebody in this school who can run these charts and you see, and know everything about them can come along and say, give you some spurious doctrine, say something I ain't never taught you. You see, and some folks are going to believe it. Why? Because the right personality said it. You see what I'm saying? And if the right personality say something else, they're going to believe that. If he switched back, they switched back to that. You get my point? Yeah. But however, you got to lay down the proof and the evidence by the pattern. I'm telling you right now, don't bet if they can't put it on the pattern. Read on so we can get out of here. Read.
Gather unto me all the elders of your tribe.
Read
and
on.
Your officers, that read. I may speak these words in their ears.
Now I'm going to talk to the folks in charge. I'm going to charge them. Read on.
And call heaven and earth to record against them.
Come on, read on.
For I know that after my death, you will utterly corrupt yourselves.
You just can't help it. You know how it is. You go on a vacation next to your kids and got a party going on at your house while you're gone. Or the things that they would never do while you're there, they when you go, oh, and it's going on up in there. You get my point? But let's move on, please. I want to get to that. Read.
And turn aside from the way which I have commanded.
In other words, they turn their back to the law that's been laid down. Come on, let's read.
And evil will befall you.
And evil will befall them. Come on.
Because ye will do evil in the sight of Yahweh.
Read.
To provoke him to anger through the work of your hand.
Read on.
And Moses spake in the ears of all the congregation of Israel the words of the song.
That's good enough right there. I want to make that real clear. I didn't get to where I want to get to. But the point is, the Gentiles was later grafted in. Can I just take 2 minutes only? Just two. I promise it won't be no more than two.
Make it a quick
Romans
one.
2. Is that got 2 minutes, Doc?
Make it a quick one.
Okay, real quick, Romans 11 and 23? I think that's what I want.
Romans 11 and 23.
Yeah, don't be rushing too fast, but read good though.
And they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in.
Talking about the Gentiles.
For Yahweh is able to graft them in again. For if thou were cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature.
Jump down to 17. I apologize. Matter of fact, make it 16 and go down now.
For is the first fruit be holy?
Read on.
The rest is also holy.
Read on.
If the root be holy, so are the branches.
So if the root be holy, then the branch is good. You say you got a root, good root. You got good fruit, you got good branches. Read on.
And if some of the branches be broken off.
If some of the branches be broken off, read on.
And thou, being a wild olive tree.
Talking about us being Gentiles, being a wild, we didn't have the law. Read on.
We're grafted in among them.
We was grafted in, just weaved in. Read on, please.
And with them partakest of the root and
fat. So we've been partaking of the fatness of the root. No, but we're receiving the gospel that they receive, even though we don't have a pattern. But we get the same benefits. Come on, read quickly.
Boast not against the branches.
Don't boast against the branches. No, don't boast against Yahweh. Read on, please.
But if thou boast, thou bearest not the root.
If you boast against the branches, then you're not receiving the substance from the root, or you're not receiving the substance from Yahweh. Let's read, please.
But the root thee.
Read on.
Thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off.
Read on.
That I might be grafted in.
Read on.
Well, because of the unbelief.
Because of unbelief, read.
They were broken off.
They were broken off. Read on.
And thou standest by faith.
Read.
Be not high-minded, but fear.
Read on.
For if Yahweh spared not the natural branches.
If he didn't spare those Jews because of unbelief, read on.
Take heed, lest he also spare not thee.
He ain't gonna spare you either, read on.
Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of Yahweh on them which fell, severity. But toward thee, goodness, if thou continue.
Read.
In his good, in his goodness.
Come on.
Otherwise, thou also shall be cut off.
Read on.
And also that they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in, mm-hmm. for Yahweh is able to graft them in again.
So if you don't, look, if you fall off and then you repent, then he'll graft you in again. Mm-hmm. You see, there's more to that. You see, about the grafting in the of the Gentiles, you come back, you see, try to be on time, you see, and learn all that you can. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We are to truly thank the Yahweh, the Father, for allowing the whole class this morning. And we hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30. Sunday mornings from 11 to 1. Fourth Sunday of every month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 in the morning to 10:45. So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies. And all donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Lori Lawless, and stand for the doxology. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign. Belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I went to the LA Festival of Books yesterday. It was downtown at USC. And I came across some Muslim booth, and they were giving out free Qurans. And so I took one, but then they had this. I got some other stuff too, but he asked like what religion I am, and I just told him about the school and the name of Yahweh. And of course, he said the name is Allah.
Uh-huh.
And then he goes, well, Yahweh's a tetragrammaton. I said, I know, but then when you add the A and the E from Adam and Eve, it makes Yahweh. But he was saying something, and I just didn't understand what he was trying to say. But
Allah is not a name, it's a title.
It's a title, yeah.
It's the Arabic version of Elohim.
Okay. So he goes, you know, and he had a little explanation as to why Allah is a name. And he goes, Yahweh's not the name, and he said, Jehovah's not the name. And I said, of course, I know Jehovah's not the name, but Yahweh's the name. Yeah. I just didn't know how to explain it the correct way, or, you know.
Yeah, well, see,
he wasn't going to get it.
Islam believed that Muhammad is the last prophet. They believe in Moses and the Old Testament.
Yeah.
They even believe in Jesus. They just don't believe him to be the incarnation of God. Allah. They believe him to be, what do they call it, the great Mahdi, a prophet. They even worship his mother.
Okay.
The Muslims, yeah, they worship, seriously, they worship Mary.
Yeah, because they mentioned, he mentioned Catholicism, and I guess they kind of, some of their teachings. They worship Mary too, right? Catholic,
yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But he wasn't trying to hear that Yahweh was the name for him. But I didn't know how would you have answered, how would you have explained that that's the name?
I would have just directed it to Moses.
Well, that's what I said. You know, I did say that. I said, but I didn't think I said it right.
Moses.
I said he was revealed to Moses, but he just,
but yeah, well,
he wasn't hearing that. I mean, there's,
some can't folks are not going to, you know, all you can do is just throw it out there as a witness.
So. Yeah, but yeah, so I did that. I did my job, and then I got a free I've never read it before, so yeah, I get some time.
Dr. Kinley called it the corruption of the Bible.
The corruption, yeah.
Nobody's going to come along in 632 AD and rewrite what Moses wrote.
Oh, I want to make one more thing clear. This number wasn't what he had on the board.
Yeah.
4,000
2017 was like 19 something. He had some different awards. I forgot what he had. 450. That was the
400. I thought he had 4,000.
Well, he had 4,000 years of Adam and
Yahshua. Right, but then you take about 2017, it was like another number. This wasn't on the board.
He's over here somewhere.
Like, that was the number I came up with. That was the number that was before. Maybe I have to look at the video. It's on the video. So.
All right.
All right. Okay.